Hey, good morning. Oh, it is good to be gathered in the Lord's house this morning. If we haven't met, I'm Jamie. I'm the director of modern worship here. It is, as always, a joy and a privilege to be here. We're starting this new worship series, Worship, A Way of Life. And so today we're talking about what does it look like? What does it feel like? What is it that we were designed and created to worship? Now this is absolutely worship within these four walls, but it's more than that, right? Worship, it extends past this time that we've set apart outside of this building. But while we're here, we bring our week's worship, whether that is full of rejoicing and full of celebration and full of joy, or whether that week, these past 7 days, have been difficult, whether there's been frustration or disappointment or loss to grapple with. But we bring all of that here today. I invite you to stand as we start our time in worship with these words of invocation, marking this time with the Lord's name. We make our beginning in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. So gathering together is a huge part of worship. It may be part of your worship schedule, this time on Sunday, and gathering in the Lord's house. We read in Scripture that one day in the house of the Lord is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I really believe that, being in a community of people praising God for what He's done and who He is. I invite you to join us as we do just that, praising God for what He's done and who He is. Let's sing.
The God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause He hung up on that cross, then He rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out. Beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely. Praise, there's joy in the house of the Lord.
God. What an amazing week, Lord. Just a week and a half ago, the desperation of the tomb, the utter disappointment gives way to the joy of Easter morning. It's true that your love truly changes everything. And even though this week the reality of our lives sets back in and all the things and tasks that we need to do and the challenges, we come back here today, Lord, to recenter ourselves and to re-anoint ourselves in that love that changes everything. Let's sing about that.
See his body breaking. I see his fingers bleed. I see the darkness tremble at the ground below his feet. And in the darkest hours, there on Calvary, he was sweetly broken, broken beautifully, broken beautifully. So come out into the waters, come let the broken sing. Come all you sons and daughters, his love changes everything. So come when the fear is fighting, finding a risen King. Come on and let the light in, your love changes everything. When the heavens open, I saw the sins of men become a crown of glory. The darkest hours in the valley, Lord, I will fear no evil. You'll never let me go. You'll never let me go. So come out into the waters. So come let the broken sing. Come on, you sons and daughters. His love changes everything. So come when the fear is fighting, finding the risen King. Come on and let the light in. Your love changes everything. Life can overcome when death has lost its sting. Your love changes everything.
You can have a seat. This morning, we continue or we begin a new series here after Easter. It's a series that's called Worship, A Way of Life, that worships more than just about an hour a week in a building. It's about all of life. And today, we're going to be diving into this idea that God created us as the crown of His creation. He created us to be a reflection of Him. We are to worship Him in everything that we do. But it doesn't take long as you open up the Bible and you see that we make a mess of it real quick. Sin comes in and distorts everything. And it doesn't take long for us also to look at our own lives and see how we can make a mess of it. How we aren't always worshiping God. In fact, we actually... We're always worshiping something. It's so easy to worship all kinds of things and follow all kinds of things. And so, as we prepare to hear from God's word, it's appropriate for us to acknowledge our brokenness, to acknowledge our need for a Savior to come that we just sang about, a Savior to give us grace and forgiveness and freedom from the sin that so easily traps us. There's this chapter in Romans chapter 7. It's one that first you read it and you're like, what? And then all of a sudden you're like, no, that's me. Listen to these words. Paul's saying, I don't understand what I do. For what I want to do, I don't do, but what I hate, I seem to do. For I don't do the good that I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do, this I just keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it's this thing called sin that's living in me that does it. And he gets to the point in saying, there's this war that's raging on against my mind and making me prisoner of the law of sin that's worked within me. He says, what a wretched person I am. I mean, think for a moment. Think about the week. And Jamie just said before, and sometimes it's you got a week, right? And there's frustrations, and there's arguments, and there's issue after issue, right? Hopefully that wasn't fully your week, but for a moment, just think about the ways that you did not follow and worship God. Maybe short answers or statements to kids or a loved one. Maybe falling into a trap that you said you wouldn't fall into. For a moment, let's go before our Heavenly Father and confess those ways that we've come up short. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as I read these words in Romans chapter 7, it resonates with each one of us that oftentimes we do what we don't want to do, but what we want to do is we don't end up doing it. We have sinned and blown it. We've made a mess in relationships. We've said things we didn't mean to. We let our thoughts go in places that we definitely shouldn't have. And so, Lord, we confess that we are infected with this thing called sin. We confess that we have messed up. And that we desperately need you. We desperately need your grace, your love that you won upon the cross for us. That's why this past week, as we celebrated Good Friday and Easter, it's so powerful. Because we need what you won there for us. So Lord, we confess and we ask for your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness. In Jesus' name, Amen. Paul says, what a wretched man I am. So who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? In the very last line in this chapter, where he goes on and on about how he is a mess, he says this, thanks be to God, who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. And so I say to you, your sins are forgiven because of Jesus. They're forgiven upon the cross. You are set free from your past and your struggles. You're forgiven in the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Live forgiven, live free in Jesus. Amen. I want to invite you to stand and share that peace that God gives with somebody else and say good morning to somebody.
I invite you to make your way back to your seat and have a seat. We've got a lot of stuff going on at Holy Cross. Even after Holy Week and Easter, there's a lot of things happening. So we've got a short announcement video highlighting some of the things coming up. Watch this.
Hi, and welcome to Holy Cross. I'm Jamie Smith, and these are your announcements for Sunday, April 7th. We have a new sermon series that starts today, and we're launching worship series conversations during our Bible study hours. Worship leaders Kaylee Girth and Jamie Mitchell will be leading conversations talking about the overall ideas behind our Worship A Way of Life series, ideas behind the sermon theme for the day, and the meaning behind certain worship elements. They invite you to stay after service or come early to be a part of the discussion. The conversations will be happening throughout the whole series, so feel free to stop in at any time. Children can attend Holy Cross Kids Bible Study, or youth can attend youth studies during that time as well. For those of you who are joining us for the first time today, we want you to know we're glad you're here. Please scan the QR codes located on the back of the pew or chairs in front of you to let us know more about you. Then make sure to stop by our Connect tables on the way out, and our team has a small gift for you. And if you've been here a few times and you're ready to learn more about our vision and values and where we're headed as a church, make sure to join us next Sunday on April 14th for Pizza with the Pastors, where you can meet our staff and learn more about Holy Cross. Please let us know if we can expect you by signing up on our website or app. And for those of you who call Holy Cross home, we want to thank you for your ongoing support of our ministries. We have a number of ways you can give to help us continue to connect, nurture, and serve at Holy Cross. And each month at Holy Cross, we have an impact offering. It's an opportunity to support an organization that's making a difference in our community. This month's impact offering is our very own Naomi Comfort Dog. Naomi is a specially trained Lutheran Church Charities K9 Comfort Dog. She and her ministry team have a 40-hour-a-week work schedule. She's not just here at Holy Cross for our church and school. She provides comfort in all types of situations to people around the Indianapolis area. She goes to other schools, nursing homes, call centers, hospitals, and visits other first responder units. She even gets deployed sometimes in crisis situations. You can give directly to the Comfort Dog Ministry team online or in the back of the room. And this month, we celebrate Naomi's 9th birthday too. Join us as we celebrate our awesome Naomi Comfort Dog on Sunday, April 21st at 12:15. We'll have pizza, cake, and bounce houses. There is no need to RSVP. Just plan to show up and celebrate Naomi. And Holy Cross is hosting another mental health workshop. We last hosted a mental health workshop in January, where 14 people attended, and the consensus among all of them was that we absolutely had to do it again and that all of Holy Cross should go. So Holy Cross will be hosting our next mental health workshop on Saturday, May 4. The workshop uses components of the Church Mental Health Summit 23. There are three different tracks you can take throughout the day that dig deeper into mental health for yourself, mental health for the church, and tools for our mental health toolbox. Check out this clip from Deborah Falada. She's an author and licensed professional counselor who speaks about spiritual first aid in the Mental Health Summit series.
So I want to push you a little today, and I want to ask you this. Are you really okay? Because most of the time, we're not okay. We're struggling. We're overwhelmed. We're lonely. We're burnt out. We're anxious. We're trying to keep afloat, and we're putting our best face forward. And I understand that in the hallways of church or on the posts of social media may not be the best time to share our deepest, darkest secrets, but we can't always live in that superficial answer. There's got to be a time where we go a little deeper. I want to take a moment today and give you permission to not be okay. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you have to be okay. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you can't be struggling. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you're healthy emotionally, mentally, or relationally. You see, it's okay not to be okay, but it's not okay to stay there. We want to acknowledge how we're really doing, but then we want to move in the direction of healing.
You see, Holy Cross wants to be a church that is truly there for each other. We long to be a church that practices the values of together over alone, being for one another, and practicing authenticity. You can head to our website or app to get more information about the mental health workshop. There's a detailed list of the different sessions you can attend and registration. If you don't have the Holy Cross app, make sure to download it today so you can see all the really neat things we have going on here. Thanks again for being here today. Enjoy the rest of your weekend.
So, lots going on. I see you. She was ready to go. Okay, it's time for Holy Cross Kids. So, we are going to send elementary school out that way, so second through fifth, and preschool, kindergarten, first grade, accompanied by a grown-up, are going to head out that a door. I love this moment. It is chaotic and loud and confusing and crazy, but it's so good. We love having kids in service, but we love age-appropriate teaching. And so they're headed out to learn the same lesson that we're learning in here. What does it mean that we were designed and created to worship, specifically looking at Genesis 1, this idea that we were designed to do things, and what does that mean? But they're learning that at an age-appropriate level. Parents, grown-ups, ask questions. Help them to grow in their understanding of God and His Word and what that all means, as well as remember to pick your kids up after service. That's another biggie. So the word good can be spread out for a whole bunch of different things. You know, my wife might make dinner one night. It's like, oh, honey, that was really good. Or, oh man, that was a really good movie. Or, oh, you're a good gift giver, or a good, you're right, this word is thrown around all the time, but when we talk about God's goodness, He is supremely good. Take this idea of good, and He is perfectly loving and patient and kind. He is full of grace. He is full of peace and joy for you. And so when we talk about the goodness of God, it's talking about, yeah, the things that God has done for us, the blessings that we are able to see in our lives. But we talk about just who God is in His infinite, limitless goodness. There's something that switches there. We sing in this song, with every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And that's what we're talking about. This worship series is about framing how does every breath, how does every interaction, how does every task you complete, how does it sing of the goodness of God? I invite you to stand as we continue our time together, rejoicing in God's goodness. Let's sing.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you are indeed good, and you created this good, this very good world. And our prayer is today that as we think about what does it mean to worship you, the Holy Spirit, you would move us to be inspired and to think that all of life is in worship to you. Inspire my thoughts and words and be in this place. Call us to challenge. Call us to life. Call us to follow you more closely, Jesus, and we ask it in your name. Amen. Please be seated. Can you imagine what it was like for those disciples that first night when suddenly Jesus appeared in the room? And they heard the story this morning that the grave was empty, didn't know where he was. But that night, he showed up in the room. Now, that was a moment they never forgot, a moment that changed their perspective on everything. The disciples are blown away as Jesus begins to reveal to them, "Do you know who I am?" And they begin to understand. He teaches them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that was written about me in the law of the prophets, about the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms." And then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. I would love to be there when Jesus is explaining the Old Testament to me. He's saying, "Let me understand, let me explain to you how the different stories, how the prophets' words all came true in me." That literally the story was about death and resurrection. That Jesus is the promised Messiah, the Savior King, that he is the one. And after Jesus showed them his hands and feet, he opened their minds and connected scripture stories together. He took them to the Bible. So it's important for us to continue to be in the Word of God and see the connections made between this. Oh, that's another Jesus thing. Oh, there's another Jesus thing. Because the more you look, the more you see the connections and the way the stories all point to the coming of Jesus. The moment, however, transformed them forever. They were never the same. When they saw Jesus, their whole perception of life was different. And he said to them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning with Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." And Jesus said, "I'm sending you to tell people what you have seen and heard." And the resurrection story transformed the life of those disciples, and it literally launched the beginning of the Christian church. The grave was empty. Nobody disputes that. But we're convinced that it was empty because Jesus actually rose from the dead. We're convinced that Jesus actually accomplished God's plan to forgive sins, to guarantee that nothing would separate us from the love of God. And all we can really do every day is live to say, "Thank you. I understand, God, what you have done for me. And if you love me that much, I will trust you." Back in our catechism days, "For all which it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him," this is most certainly true. If I understand what Jesus has done, thank and praise, serve and obey, it becomes my life. It's a life of worship. And in a way, that very same moment is happening here today. Because here in church is where the waters of baptism wash sins away. And Jesus says, "I'm present here. Put my name on people. I'm present here." Here in church, in communion, Jesus says, "This is my body and blood here in this place for the forgiveness of your sins." Here you say, "God, please forgive me. I'm sorry." And the pastor says, as a culminating sermon, "I forgive your sins." Here we pray and ask God things. Here God is present. There's a moment we have together when we gather for worship as the people of God. Here on Sunday morning. And every Sunday we celebrate Easter together. We remember he's risen indeed. Now most people think that this is worship. But this morning we're starting a new sermon series. And it's called Worship, a Way of Life. And the tagline is, you always worship something. And the idea is to take the next couple weeks and say, worship is not just this. Paul wrote it this way, "Whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." No matter what, in everything that you do, it's an act of worship. It's giving thanks to God. Now, most of us, when we hear the word worship, we think of getting in the car and driving to church on Sunday morning to a building. The sermon series, we're going to dig into that a little bit. The worship is more. What do we do with the other 167 hours of the week? And found, yes, actually, we were created to worship. So let me ask you a question, because this popped in my mind a couple times in my life. Sometimes I think, I'm not really sure I want to go to heaven. Because if all you're going to do there is like a 24-7 worship service and sing with the angels, I don't know about you, sounds kind of boring. And so I want to take you back to the beginning. What was worship really supposed to be like? And in the beginning, it says, God created the heavens and the earth and everything, and he said, after 6 days, it's very good. And on the seventh day, he rested. Now, he didn't rest because he was tired. He took a rest to just enjoy the beauty of it all, how amazing it all was. He took a rest to set a pattern, a habit for us to follow the rest of our days. That there are 6 days of work, and the seventh day we stop and we rest. Not just rest because we're tired and take a nap, but it's really rest unto the Lord. Every 7 days I stop and remember, God, you are God and I am not. And I want to make sure my relationship with you is solid and good. It's about connecting with God in this relationship. That's the seventh day. And we were placed in this garden. It says it was very good. We weren't put there to eat bonbons and take a nap all day. That was never the purpose of the creation. We're not having an eternal vacation, and we're not sitting in chairs singing with the angels all the time. So let's go back. They were worshiping, but they had no church. They had no hymnal, no liturgy, no order of service. They had no organ, no guitars. They had no Bible. They had no pastor. They were worshiping because all of their life was lived with God, doing things in a relationship with God. They were given responsibility to take care of the garden, but they were created with purpose and meaning. They were created to be creative. They were created with intelligence to explore things and figure things out. They were created with ingenuity and ideas to sort of creatively bring ideas together. How will we do this? What did that look like? And sort of bring all that to bear in the way they took care of the garden. There was psychology. They had to learn how to relate to each other. And as people grew, more people, the idea of how do relationships work and what do we do with all that? There was engineering and botany and horticulture. It wasn't boring. They had this beautiful creation to enjoy and to take care of. And worship wasn't just a small part of their life. So I got like my life and then there's worship. It was never intended to be that way. Worship was just a part of all of it. They were walking with God in the garden, talking with God as they lived and did things. They had a relationship with God in everything that they did. The worship disconnect came with the fall into sin. And that relationship with God and with each other got broken, and we've been bad at worshiping ever since. Worship became a task, a chore, a ritual to perform, a religious duty. And eventually we created worship with the Sabbath day, one day a week. And as time went along, worship became sort of an hour one day a week. And since COVID, it's been an hour every couple of weeks. Where I have my life, and this worship's a little piece over here that I go and do. That was never the intention for what worship was about. Worship was always supposed to be all of my life in a relationship with God. But sin ruined that very good world. And it brings out the worst in us. With broken promises and broken hearts and broken dreams and broken relationships with God and broken relationships with each other. And even though the Holy Spirit's still working in our life, sort of inspiring us and challenging us to follow the way of Jesus, I just tend to tune him off, even on Sundays. So I have this dream, because by the way, up here, we can actually see when you fall asleep, just so you know. I'm just sort of hopping down, sitting next to somebody and just going, boo. Because even in worship, we try to do things that are engaging and thoughtful and worshipful, but even in worship, it's hard to just like pay attention for an hour. I mean, come on, people. I'm killing it up here. No. And then I'll have those moments in the morning when I actually worship. I do my devotions, and I'm all prayed up. And Charlie will come out and be just lazy and not do what he's supposed to be doing or whatever, and I snap at him. Or I leave worship on Sunday morning. I go home and say some sort of cutting remark, snide comment that just sort of, you know, in the old classic line, like, what's up with that? Even when I worship, I find that I can't like sustain that relationship with God. Life was supposed to revolve around God, with God at the center, but most of the time, it revolves around me. So I need worship to remind me what's true, to remind my pea brain of what's really important, of the focus of life, what really matters, that I am not God, and I need him. And worship can't be just a Sunday morning thing, because we're trying to combat temptations in the world all the time, all the stuff in life, trying to pull me away from God or away from worshiping or away from a worshipful kind of life. There's so many other influences in life and things that make me frustrated and things that kick in my shame cycles and make me wonder if I'm ever going to be enough. Can I ever stop that? What's wrong with me? Or guilt. What was I thinking? Why did I do that? Or there are habitual sins that sort of keep finding their way back, and I think I've licked it, and doggone there, I'm doing it again. Or there are certain people that just push my buttons. You know those kind of people, right? Irritate the snot out of you, but there they are. And you got to deal with them. And all the time, they're just there, and situations are tense, and I'm under pressure, and I'm under stress. I mean, come on. In a life like that, worship has got to bring me back to where I actually fit in my relationship with God. I want to keep this relationship with God in the midst of my heart, when I'm in the midst of a sinful world, where the curse of sin means that my work has weeds and thorns and thistles. That's the way the garden described it, that thorns and thistles will now grow up to make work hard for you. I understand that. I get it. And woven into the fabric of life, before there was even sin, was this pattern of 6 days of working, seventh day rest. We'll talk about them more in later Sundays. But this idea that there was a pattern of stopping to remember who God is. Every 7 days, stop working and tending the garden to be with God, to rest unto the Lord, to focus again on my relationship with God. If I don't have a habit of every 7 days stopping, I'll just keep plowing through and I'll work and I'll stay busy. I'll never stop. So what did God intend our lives to be? He said, be fruitful and multiply, have kids, have family. And work, take care of the garden. It was not sitting on a beach reading books. It was not being lazy and taking a nap. It was not forever church service. They were literally supposed to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. It was about, how do I love God and love the people beside me? But we've turned it into pride. Look at me. Look what I'm doing. Did you notice? By the way, did you notice? It's Dave. Or envy. I'm trying to compare myself with everybody else. How do I fit in the pecking order? How do I measure up compared to them? And I'm always wondering, am I enough? How do I measure up? Or I'll find myself hoarding and not being generous because I don't know if God's really going to provide or take care. I don't know if I have enough. So I better take care of myself. Or there are dysfunctional relationships. They're just broken and a mess. Or there are power structures in place just to keep some people in power and other people oppressed. Or there's just abusing the creation itself. It's a mess. Sin literally messed it all up. And our perspective got messed up as well. Our perspective on what matters most got twisted. Instead of life being worship, I have my life and worship. So let me ask you to take a moment together this morning to reexamine why. Why do you work so hard? Why do you care so much about your kids being successful? Hear what my kid did? Let me show you a picture. Why does your stuff matter so much to you? And why do you fret and worry all the time? Why? Jesus Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. See, anytime the pastor could pull out the words, and you just chime them right back. But Easter was last week. I mean, the Easter baskets are back in the box, and they're going back in the attic. The Easter eggs are put away. Easter, hey, it happened. It went. Bye, Easter. You're done for another year. As if somehow we just sort of passed by Easter once again. If my sins are truly paid for, and I really am forgiven, and the God of the universe knows my name and knows everything about me and still loves me, And me and God were good. We're very good. Why is it that we still find life being so distorted? Why do we find ourselves worshiping the creation instead of the Creator? But it happens all the time. So here's what I've learned. It's the tagline. We're always worshiping something. There's always an it, whatever it is that I am striving to achieve, to accomplish. Maybe it is happiness, as long as you're happy. Or maybe it's financial stability. I got to have enough so I can retire. I'm never going to be in a position where we can't pay our bills and I'm struggling to make ends meet. I hate that position. We're never doing that again. Maybe it's financial stability. Maybe it is a promotion. Maybe it is grades on a test. Maybe it is making the team. What is it that you are currently worshiping? If somebody was watching your life and sort of following you around all day long and so every 15 minutes sort of jot down what you did for that 15 minutes, what would they say you are worshiping? Remember what Paul wrote? And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That all of our life is to be worshiped. I do life with Jesus, not for Jesus. I'm not doing stuff to sort of check off the box. What I did for you today, Jesus. I went to church. I said my prayers. Did my things. Check, 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 check. It wasn't a checklist of things to do for Jesus. It was really a life lived with him. In a relationship with the Holy Spirit guiding and directing the way that I see. So, tomorrow in Indianapolis, for 4 minutes, the world's going to go nuts here. For 4 minutes, the sun will be the center of the universe of our day. The total eclipse will happen. It will be awesome. It will be memorable. It's actually pretty cool. You know, 400th of the sun, 400 miles away, so when you see it, it looks like the same size. Could be coincidence. Could be God did it that way. So you go, but it will be a moment. And people will stop and they will look up at the sky in an almost worship-like quality. They'll witness something that's rare that they don't always see, something that's beyond themselves that captivates your imagination. It's cool. And people will return home telling about the stories of the spectacular thing. They'll wear their silly glasses. We'll talk about it at school. We'll hear about it on the news. But the Son of God came to earth, died and rose again from the dead. But Easter's last week's old news. How is that possible? That the story of God's incredible love and the story of Jesus, the Son of God, is overshadowed, literally, by the moon and the sun. So I was privileged, really. I grew up in a house where my dad, my stepdad's a choir director and musician and organist, and worship was kind of part of our home life because it was his job. He'd be sitting playing the piano and getting ready. And so worship was kind of one of those cool things in my life. And he was good, so we did, like, trumpets and organs. When the clavinova came out with little sequences of instruments, we had different instruments playing along with the organ and the piano. It was cool. We sang with choir people that came, professionals. We did cool music. It was worshipful. It was awesome. At the time I was a kid, I loved to sing, kindergarten, you know. And throughout my grade school years, it was me and Valerie Rogers singing at the top of our lungs. Who could sing the loudest? And it was cool. She became a professional singer. I became this. So. But the idea of worshiping and singing songs, you know, I bet you have moments. Moments of worship that come to mind when you sense the presence of God. Maybe it's that moment of Christmas Eve singing Silent Night, holding the candle. Maybe it's Good Friday night and the closing hymn when you're whispering the Lord's Prayer. Maybe it's trumpets playing on Easter. Or maybe it's standing on the top of a mountain going, this is beautiful. Or for me, sunrise on the beach. Or maybe it's a moment when you're just so broken, you don't know what to think or do next, and you're just in tears and go, God, I don't know, help. That there are worshipful moments throughout our life when the God of the universe intersects with our life. And it wasn't intended to be just moments. Here's my assignment for the week. Yes, if you want to tell me about the eclipse next Sunday, I'll go, yeah, it was really cool. Did you get pictures? Yeah, we'll talk about it together. My family's all here. House is crazy. It's going to be cool tomorrow. I get it. But what if instead I said, next week, how was your worship like this week? From the time you get up in the morning to the time you went to bed at night, you begin to see that it's not like life and worship, but that all that I do is done to give thanks and praise to God. Everything I do is to use the best that God wired me up to be, to love God, to love people, to create moments in life when Jesus is present and people get that they're loved and forgiven. And Jesus is not just a story in a book or a story of history. Actually, the Jesus who comes to life and frees me and brings me this profound sense of peace that I don't know where it comes from. It's unexplainable. A moment when I literally know that I'm free of sin and the stuff that I've done. Moments. Worshipful moments. What if there is a conversation this week between you and God that says, God, I think I need to shift my perspective. Worship is not just this. It's every moment of every day, going into a meeting, having a tough conversation, driving my kids to school, fixing dinner, taking out the trash. When that guy sort of cuts me off and I want to just go up and worshipful moment. And all of a sudden, I become transformed in the way that I see life, not just as separated from God, but back the way it was intended to be. Me and God doing life together. Worship. Amen? Will you stand with me? There's God and Father in heaven, this idea of all of life being worshipful, being worship. Everything that I do is done to give you thanks and praise and to show you that I love you and spread your love to people around. When all of my life becomes a way of giving thanks and praise, it changes what I say and how I say it and the way I think about the moments of my day. So transform our thoughts and transform our hearts, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Lord, we reach out today and for the family of Alice Vernatter, who's now with you in heaven, especially her husband Bill. You would bring him a sense of comfort and peace as he mourns these days. And with Christina Herbert and Steve Traeger, who were married yesterday, bless their love for each other and let them be to each other this picture of someone who knows me and offers me grace and forgiveness, that they see the love of Jesus in one another. Be with Grace Stefanoff, who's recovering from surgery, and Herm Sander, who's now in hospice care. Be with the Oldham family as you're walking Courtney and their baby through to the baby's birth, to keep them both safe and healthy. And walk with Ellen Hananiah. She's now recovering from being hospitalized for so long. Continue to restore her and strengthen her. Be with those in a battle with cancer, especially Joyce and Todd and Megan and Justin LaFrenz's dad and Chrissy Temme's father and Maya Adams. Our prayer is you would bring healing to their bodies and give them the courage to face the treatments that are sometimes challenging and painful and exhausting. Be with Wayne Schmidt and Pat Hall and Pastor Dan's mother, Connie. They're in situations where they're slowly fading away and no longer completely themselves, and that's hard for them and it's hard for those who are taking care of them to just watch and be a part of it. So our prayer is, God, you would keep them strong in faith every day until you call them home to be with you in heaven, and that's our prayer for them today. We pray for ministries in our area and other churches, for Summit Church at Sunnyside and Epiphany Lutheran Church in Westfield and Fisher's First United Methodist Church. Walk with them and their pastors and leadership, that they literally would be a witness to the love of Jesus, that they'd communicate the truth of the gospel, that people would come to find hope and forgiveness in Jesus there. And last of all, Holy Spirit, we open our hearts to you, to change the way we see life, that we would see all life as worship, as done in thanksgiving and praise to you. Not that we're going to stop and sing songs all day, but Everything we do is to give honor and praise for the gifts that we have, for the love of Jesus in our life. To that end, bless us this week, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. After worship today, there'll be some folks up front. If you need somebody to pray with or something you need to pray for, they'd love to do that with you before you leave this morning. I invite you to cup your hands. We have this tradition, if you're new to Holy Cross, of cupping our hands, and the idea is that God pours his love and grace into us so it would overflow, first of all, to each other, that the church becomes this place that's not just talking about forgiveness, we actually like love and forgive each other. But also, when we leave these doors, we take this love of Jesus and it overflows in the way we love and forgive people around us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his unending peace. You have been blessed by this God to then go and be a blessing to others. Amen. Let's sing.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. The only one who could ever say, worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. Your heart and lead me in.
Thank you so much for joining us in worship this morning. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Have a great week.
Thanks again for worshiping with us. You know, we'd love for this to not be just today. We'd love for you to be a part of this community in whatever way you would like to. And so reach out, let us know how we can be praying for you, or how we can come alongside of you. Or maybe you would like to get involved in a small group or a Bible study or serve in some kind of way. You know, I'd love to grab a cup of coffee with you or grab lunch and just hear a little more about your story and get to know you a little bit better. Or if you're far away, we have a Bible study that we can send you based completely on this message you just heard. Thank you for being a part of our community, and we hope that you would consider us a part of your family, your extended family, as we go on this thing called life together.